everybody. Can everybody hear me? Yeah. Probably take away this mic, you can probably still hear me. I just want to thank everyone who contributed to putting this panel together, and thank you to the ISA for asking me to be a part. I asked what the prompt was for tonight, and they said I could talk about whatever I wanted to. And y'all know I could talk a lot. So, but for our time here tonight, I thought what would be helpful is first I'm going to tell you guys a little bit about myself, because people ask me lots of questions about myself. And then the three things with the movement that I really wanted to hit on tonight was the biggest thing that I see about how people think and talk about the situation of black folks in America, the biggest issue I see in how we act, and then I'm going to hit on some really practical key things I think we need to get at in this city, Seattle specifically. So I am a professional nanny of infant twins. I'm an avid church lady. I graduated from Seattle Pacific University in 2013. And when I graduated, all my friends and my professors had a nickname for me. It was Rabbi Reverend Dr. Marissa. So please don't mind if I preach at you a little bit. I think one thing that's important for people to know about me and how I come about this work is I have spent a lot of time in extremely white spaces trying to earn whiteness in a lot of ways. Thinking that if I just got the right grades, if I got the right degrees, if I did the right work, like someday I could achieve that. I learned the hard way that you can't out-earn your blackness. Okay? But in that, I was usually very the token black person in the spaces that I was in. And over the past several years, as I think people go through cycles of racial awakening and understanding their place in this world, when Trayvon Martin was killed in the subsequent trial that happened after that, I realized that I was experiencing that alone in the midst of white communities who are like, oh, whatever, you shouldn't, you know. And that really broke me down and challenged my worldview. And then when Mike Brown was killed, I won't forget it because I was in my apartment, sitting in the corner of my apartment, crying for hours by myself as all my roommates walked past me. And I spent much of the time between his death and the non-indictment of Derek Wilson mourning and crying and fearing, trying to figure this shit out by myself. Excuse my language. Trying to figure this stuff out by myself. I didn't know where to go or how to get plugged in, but I knew that people were going to be at Westlake on the night of the non-indictment. We all knew what it was going to be, and so I got off of work, and I went down there, and I was like, you know what? I don't know what the solution is to this, but all I know is that if I'm going to cry, I'm not going to cry alone. And so the night that Darren Wilson was not indicted was the first time I've ever been to a protest or a demonstration. But that was the first time, only to say, and I was thrown into a radical community of people who speak truth and who, like, sacrifice for each other and who love each other. I mean, it's just been so amazing to be in these communities where I really, you know, being Christian, I really feel like the least of these are held up. But that all that to say is I'm very new to this game, and anybody who wants to be thrown in can be thrown in. Even if you're a nanny, even if you're a church lady. One of the biggest issues that I think has frustrated me in how people talk and think about the movement is nobody is talking about our situation in the terms that we need to be talking about it, okay? People aren't getting arrested, they're getting kidnapped, right? I really do believe that we need to be talking about the state of black folks in America in the terms that they're in and not care about offending anybody. Quite frankly, I'll be real on this. Quite frankly, we can't wait for white people to decide that we can be free. We can't wait. I guarantee you, if white folks were somehow going to come around and give us our freedom, I'm sure they would have done it by now. I don't think that black people are still persecuted and oppressed because we have not asked nicely enough. Right? So I think we really needed to talk about this in the terms that we're supposed to talk about it. And quite frankly, be honest, a lot of people come to me and talk about the work that I'm doing, and they presume that my goal is to make the white powers that be like me or think I'm a nice person. That is not my goal. To be clear, I don't think it matters whether the powers that be think I'm a nice person or whether they're afraid of me. Both can achieve the same goal. The end goal is black liberation. And unfortunately, fear might get us there faster than morality. So I think it's really important that all of us talk about these issues in the grave seriousness that we find ourselves in. The second thing that I think is really important about how people act on this, agitation work is key to what we're doing here. There are a lot of people that are doing great, like building work, education work, and guess what? You know what happens to them? I talk to them all the time. They hit roadblock after roadblock after roadblock, and of systems trying to hold them back and stop them and keep them down. That's why the agitation work is really important. Agitation is accountability. Going out making somebody feel uncomfortable, going out and hitting somebody's paycheck, going out and stopping an intersection, that's really important. Try to separate it and say, oh, well, we're building over here and you guys are just stopping this or whatever. And it's like, first of all, we're all one struggle. Second of all, if folks aren't uncomfortable, and most of all, if folks' pocketbooks aren't hit, their wallets aren't hit, in this capitalistic system that we're in, we will see no change. And so I really think that everybody has to be engaged in agitation work. And that doesn't mean just being in the street and stopping intersections. That means whatever circles you're in, if you're not making it uncomfortable for somebody to live in this racist, capitalistic society that we're in, that treats people the way they're in, you're not doing the work. We all have power in our different spaces to be resisting. It is not enough to just passively let stuff go by. We need to constantly be speaking truth to power, calling things out. And you know what? Honestly, I really don't care how much people are inconvenienced while people are dying. So we all need to step up. Even if you can't get out in the streets, even if you can't take certain risks or whatever, you can still be doing agitation work in your own context. And the last thing I'm going to say is two things that I think are really important for the movement here in Seattle moving forward. One of those is our absolutely horrific and corrupt and abusive Seattle Police Department. I came out to the streets because of my town, and I stayed because of the Seattle Police Department. They are untrained, they are unruly, and they are unaccountable, and we cannot let it continue. They already had a lot of division within their ranks. They're already having, we'll call it pressure, put on them by the DOJ. We as a community need to continue to pressure them. We need to continue to hold them accountable. We need to continue to go into city council meetings and say, actually, what you just said right there is a lie. Forward. And then the second thing, as I wrap up really quickly, that's really important. There can be no youth jail built in this city. Responsible for those two issues getting handled in our city.